In World War II, 61 United States Army divisions were locked in mortal combat with the enemy, the European theater of operations. This film is about one of those divisions, the 10th Armored. Its nickname was the Tiger Division.
The 10th Armored Division was activated at Fort Benning, Georgia, on the 15th of July, 1942. From the very beginning, it was known as a hot outfit. Its nickname, Tiger Division. The commanding general of the 10th, Major General Paul W. Newgarden, was a superb leader. Carry out orders, march, maneuver, and shoot were his bywords. No man had more pride in his troops, and no general was more revered by his men.
I'm John Drew Devereaux. I was a company commander in the 10th Armored Division during World War II. We had a marvelous kind of spirit in our division, and I think it was due in great part to the training we got from General Newgarden, who was our division commander in the States. He was killed in an airplane crash before we went overseas. Now, he had a couple of very pet things that he liked. One, that we had to wear the top button of our coveralls buttoned. This was pretty uncomfortable, but after a while we got so that we looked at other outfits who wore them unbuttoned and we thought they looked like slobs. He had a kind of thing that he liked to do about the salute. When you gave a salute in the 10th Armored Division, a tiger salute, you lifted your chin up in the air like that. That seemed pretty silly, too, until after a while we got used to it, and then we thought we were the only outfit in the whole army that knew how to salute properly.
In July 1944, a new leader assumed command of the division following General Newgarden's death.
I am Lieutenant General William H.H. Morris, Jr., U.S. Army, retired. I was commanding general of the 10th Armored Division in Europe during World War II.
The division sailed from New York on September 14, 1944. The long period of training was over. The men were prepared for anything, but their wildest imagination could not conjure up what destiny held in store for them. 2 days later, on the 16th of September, Hitler, meeting with his most trusted generals, made a momentous decision. A decision which would alter the course of the war. Operation Christ Rose, the Ardennes Offensive, a campaign in which the Tigers of the 10th would cover themselves with glory and make military history. The division arrived in battle-torn Cherbourg on the 22nd of September and was immediately assigned to General Walton Walker's 20th Corps, which was under control of General George S. Patton's 3rd Army.
General Patton came to visit our division and talk to the officers and non-commissioned officers, as he did with all the divisions that were assigned to his army. General Patton covered very effectively the combat lessons learned during the war at the squad, section, and platoon level. I'm Colonel Thomas Chamberlain. During World War II, I commanded the 11th Tank Battalion of the 10th Armored Division.
I can remember vividly the first days of combat, the first orders we received. Colonel Roberts called us into a small churchyard in the town of Chalons-sur-Marne. His first words were that the reason he called us into this particular churchyard in this particular town were that this was the place that he had received his first orders to go into combat during World War I, and he wanted to use this particular spot to start us off. We moved up all afternoon past Verdun and in the vicinity of Metz, and then that evening, in a beautiful moonlight night, it happened to be Halloween night, we infiltrated our half tracks one by one, 3 minutes apart, down a very spooky road through a village and up into a wooded area, dismounted and then trucked on up and relieve the 90th Division. I'm William R. Desabray. I was a battalion commander, a major in the 10th Armored Division in World War II.
The 10th Armored Division was a very well-trained division. Its first combat was against Metz. Metz was, you might call it a defensive sector as far as the 10th was concerned. We were supposed to aggressively patrol, and we did. We saw that every instrument and every weapon was fired at least once in more or less anger against the enemy.
I'm William Lynn Roberts, Brigadier General, U.S. Army retired. I was Combat Command Commander of CCB 10th Armored Division in World War II.
I'm Colonel Curtis L. Hankins. I was a battalion commander of the 61st Armored Infantry Battalion in the 10th Armored Division. My first encounter with enemy fire was during the defensive operation west of Metz. It was here that we learned to sense artillery fire, that is, determine the difference between outgoing, which was friendly fire, incoming, which was German fire. If you could determine with some degree of accuracy where the enemy rounds were going to land, this would save a lot of wear and tear on your knees and elbows, and you'd try to take cover every time the rounds would come over.
I am Colonel James O'Hara. I commanded the 54th Armored Infantry Battalion of the 10th Armored Division. I consider that this initial baptism of fire in a defensive position was very good for the battalion. It gave us time to gather our thoughts, practice some of the things we'd been learning in the States, get our communications working, having the reconnaissance platoon work with the Free French, practice patrolling, all these things that's so necessary for a battalion to do.
I remember my first day in combat. We felt very safe in a tank. But during this first day, after I seen the first tank hit by 88 and burn, we began to get scared. But even though we were awful scared, it didn't seem to be much of a handicap of doing our job, which was to destroy the enemy. And we did a fairly good job that first day. My name's John Winter. I was a tank platoon sergeant, 10th Armored Division during World War II.
After fighting for about 3 weeks around Metz, we moved north to the vicinity of the town of Thionville to participate in the Third Army offensive designed to capture Metz.
The plan of 20th Corps, to which the 10th Armored was assigned, had two phases: to destroy the enemy in Metz and to catch him as he tried to pull out of Metz. The mission of the 10th was to make a deep penetration into the enemy's lines. Once it had crashed through the German defense, the left column, Combat Command B, was to advance east and seize a bridgehead over the Saar River near Mürzig. The right column, Combat Command A, was to take the division objective, including Husenville, which was the center of arterial highway and railroad traffic running northeast of Metz. The enemy blocked the way and fought savagely. But the Tigers clawed their way through the German defense. By the time the division had completed its first major offensive mission, it had taken 64 towns, repulsed 11 counterattacks, captured 2,000 prisoners, and destroyed great quantities of materiel. But the price was high. On December 7th,
Hitler approved the final draft of Operation Christ Rose, now renamed Watch on the Rhine. Hitler's plan of attack was to break through on the Ardennes with three armies. The 6th Panzer Army, led by the butcher from Bavaria, Sepp Dietrich. The 5th Panzer Army, led by Baron Hasse von Manteuffel. And the 7th Army, led by General Brandenburger. They would cross the Meuse River on the second day between Liège and Namur, bypass Brussels, and reach the great port of Antwerp on the seventh day. This operation, Hitler believed, would destroy more than 30 American and British divisions. He believed it would be the beginning of the end for the Allies. Within the next week, thousands upon thousands of troops and thousands upon thousands of tons of materiel were transported secretly from assembly areas to terminals just behind the front lines. On the eve of December 15th, 250,000 Germans stood poised on the line of departure, prepared to annihilate the enemy. Hitler's great drive to Antwerp had begun.
On December the 16th, 1944, about 6 p.m., I received a telephone call from General Walker, the 20th Corps, informing me that I was going to be transferred with the entire division to the 1st Army and be placed under the 8th Corps, that there had been an attack by the Germans in the vicinity of Luxembourg. I immediately dispatched my chief of staff to Bastogne, the headquarters of the 8th Corps, for orders. The chief of staff returned about 2 a.m. the next morning and informed me that the division was to go into a quartering area just west of Luxembourg.
When the Battle of the Bulge began, my unit was in a rest area south of Luxembourg. We received orders to be prepared to move north on 24 hours' notice. A short time later, the alert was changed to 12 hours. A short time later, we were on the road.
The 10th Armored Division sent two of its combat commands northwest of Luxembourg to go into action there, and they sent my combat command west to Arlon and then on to north to Bastogne. I preceded my outfit into Bastogne and got into Bastogne about 4 o'clock in the afternoon and found General Middleton. General Middleton asked me how my outfit fought and how many pieces my outfit would fight in. I told him 3. He said, all right. Send one to Noville, which is 6 or 7 kilometers north, one east to Longville, and one southeast to Bra. A little sidelight here. I had held up the march of our outfit to get O'Hara in front because O'Hara had not been in the fighting heavily down around the Merzig area. So we got O'Hara in front, and I sent him out to Bra.
I took my team down this road toward Wilts, and we stopped for the night opposite the town of Warden. On our way down this road, we passed many American soldiers coming to the rear, most of whom seemed to be from the 28th Division. Apparently, they'd been hit hard further forward. When we got to our destination for the night, since we received our orders at 5 in the afternoon and there was not much daylight left, we settled astride the road and blocked the road to Wilts.
I arrived in Bastogne just as night was falling. I found a MP who led me to Colonel Robert C.P. It was a very brief meeting, and Colonel Robert C.P. told me that O'Hara had been sent out to the east of the town and was in a defensive position, and that Cherry was moving out slightly to the northeast of the town. And as soon as my column arrived, I was to keep moving and move to the north of the town to a little place called Noville. If there are any Germans in Noville, I was to knock them out of the town and to occupy it. If there were no Germans, I was to occupy Noville, going no further north, because this would be the limit on the range of the 10th Armored Division artillery, which was located in the vicinity of Bastogne.
This then was the disposition of Combat Command B on the 18th of December, the night of their arrival in Bastogne. Team Desaubry was at Noville. Team Cherry at Longbilly. Team O'Hara at Warden. The total strength of the three defending units was about 75 tanks and 2,800 officers and men. Battering at the gates of Bastogne were the advance elements of General Manteuffel's 5th Panzer Army and General Brandenburger's 7th Army. Approximately 300 tanks and 50,000 men, whose mission, in addition to taking Saint-Vit and Wilt, was to take Bastogne, and to take it fast.
Bastogne schnell zu nehmen, denn es kam auch darauf an.
It was very important to capture Bastogne fast. It was the most important road junction in the southern area of the Ardennes combat section, and in the event General Eisenhower's reserve forces, which we suspected were near Reims, arrived to attack, they would have to pass Bastogne.
Ankamen und gegen uns angesetzt wurden, mussten sie in jedem Falle über Bastogne kommen.
Ich bin General der Panzertruppe Hasso von Manteuffel.
I am Hasso Eckhardt von Manteuffel, former General of the Panzer Troops and Commander-in-Chief of the 5th Panzer Army.
We completed establishing the defenses of Noville about midnight. Actually, the defense was a routine, traditional type defense. We set out roadblocks to the east, one to the north, and one to the northwest, because these were the directions that we expected the Germans to attack us. The fighting throughout the night was sporadic. It was a piecemeal attack. They would hit us with small units from the north, and then they'd hit us with small units from the east.
Cherry, who's not here, went out to Longbilly, came back at midnight, and found me asleep. He asked that he be allowed to sit on a road out east of Margaret, short of Longbilly, because he had found a combat command CCR of the 9th Armored Division in position. 10 or 12 tanks, a colonel, and some artillery. I gave him permission to stay where he was. Cherry never got back to his command. In the meantime, some of the Panzer Lehr division had cut in behind his outfit at Magaret, and he never joined. However, his headquarters went into the little Neffy Chateau. At Neffy Chateau, Cherry had a tank or two and a few machine guns and his whole headquarters company, and he put up a real nice fight all day. That evening he had to retire. He felt like he had to get out because he was being burnt out. Cherry lined up his vehicles to go out. He was to go out last in a Jeep. He went outside. He got two Tommy guns. He emptied one Tommy gun to the right, got the other, opened it to the left, climbed in his Jeep and pulled out. The driver was hit, the Jeep was hit, the medico in the back was hit. Cherry got out. He got a DSC for this.
My battalion spent the night on the high ground south of Warden. And all night long we saw no German troops or heard nothing of them. However, we did have one straggler come to the rear who told us they were east of us in the Wilts area. About 10 o'clock in the morning, they came down from the Wilts Road and shot up the artillery observer's tank and one or two other tanks. We fought on all morning long and part of the afternoon, staying in the same position there, keeping the Germans at bay.
At first, the defense of Bastogne rested with three units of the 10th Armored Division. Task Force de Sobry in the northeast, Task Force Cherry in the east, and Task Force O'Hara in the southeast. I am General Anthony McAuliffe, United States Army retired. I was at Bastogne with the 101st Airborne Division in mid-December 1944. The 101st Airborne Division was at a place called Camp Mourmelon near the city of Reims in France. We were recuperating from the Holland Airborne operation where we had suffered about 30% casualties, and we were absorbing our replacements and going through a training program. General Taylor had been recalled to Washington, and I was the acting commander of the division. I believe it was on December 18th that we received a telephone call from the Chief of Staff of the 18th Airborne Corps saying that the division should be prepared to move the following day to the north to the town of Verbermont. We had known that the Germans had attacked, but we didn't know the extent of the attack or the conditions to the north. But we made all preparations to get away the following day. And the first thing in the morning, I preceded the division to the north in a sedan with my aide-de-camp and my operations officer. As I drove north, I reached a crossroad just a couple of miles west of the town of Bastogne. I knew that 8th Corps headquarters was located in that town, so I decided to drive over to that Corps headquarters and try to learn something more about the situation. It was fortunate that I did so because I learned from the Corps commander, General Middleton, that the orders for the 101st Airborne Division had been changed and that the division would come to Bastogne rather than to go to Verbermont. I also met there Colonel Roberts, who was the commander of Combat Command B of the 10th Armored Division, who were already on the scene and already in the fighting.
Desbury was attacked about five or six times that first day. He will describe. During the morning of that first day, one battalion under Colonel Prade of the 101st Airborne joined him. They, as soon as Colonel Prade joined, they decided to attack. Apparently at the same time, the Germans decided to attack.
1,400 hours, paratroopers, and our tanks and our armored infantry launched the attack. In 1,400 hours, the German forces launched an all-out attack on Mobile. So we had the situation of the Germans and the American units attacking one another simultaneously from points about 700 yards distance. Actually, the Germans were stopped. They withdrew back behind the ridge. Our paratroopers on the northwest of the town actually gained the ridge. The tanks, the armored infantry, and the paratroopers on the northeast of the town were unable to get to their positions. So after a fight of about 45 minutes or an hour, we withdrew the paratroopers from the northeast back into the town of Noville.
Desabre was hit badly, and Colonel Praed was killed that evening. And I didn't know Desabre was hurt for 24 hours. He was later captured when the hospital was captured.
For the next 3 days and nights, the defenders of Bastogne slugged it out with the numerically superior enemy. Then, on the 22nd of December, when the besieged city was finally encircled, the commanding general of the 47th Panzer Corps sent the following surrender ultimatum. It called for the surrender of the Bastogne garrison if the Americans did not comply within 2 hours. Bastogne would be completely destroyed and its defenders annihilated. General McAuliffe's one-word answer, nuts, reverberated around the world. On the 16th of December 1944, Hitler began his great drive to the port of Antwerp, the Ardennes offensive. Six days later, on the 22nd of December, strong German forces surrounded the outnumbered and outgunned American defenders of Bastogne, a key communication center, vital to the success of Hitler's plan. As a result of this encirclement, the commanding general of the German 47th Panzer Corps delivered a surrender ultimatum to General Anthony McAuliffe, commander of the Bastogne garrison. General McAuliffe's reply to the German commander was nuts. Fighting in the beleaguered city was Combat Command B of the 10th Armored Division. From the very beginning of the battle for Bastogne, heavy fog and bad flying weather prevented aerial resupply and fighter support. There was a shortage of surgical equipment and not enough blankets for the men suffering from wounds and shock. Ammunition was running low, and some of the artillery batteries were down to less than 10 rounds per gun. But the morning of December 23rd broke clear and cold. Visibility was unlimited from England to the foxholes of Bastogne, where every man looked up to the sky and prayed, and their prayers were answered.
I'm William Lynn Roberts, Brigadier General, U.S. Army retired. I was Combat Command Commander of CCB 10th Armored Division in World War II. The 19th TAC, we called them, furnished us every half hour a squadron of planes which circled us. At the same time, by some luck, a captain staggered into Bastogne. How he got there, I don't know, but he was an expert on operating with the air from the ground.
We had a fine VHF set which could work with the air. We set that thing up in the middle of the compound, and he used the air as follows. The airplanes carried napalm bombs, ordinary bombs, rockets, and what he called bullets. He says, I pulled the napalm bombs first, then I pulled the bombs next, I pulled the rockets next, and then I gave them bullets, and before I let them go, I made them circle once to give us new targets. I have estimated that the air was equal to at least two divisions of health. Because they could see in the snow, which had newly fallen, where the tanks had gone, and they were able to bomb all of these little woods. And at one time, they found a column moving right toward the 4th Armored Division, which was battling to get into us. And I think the next air squadron destroyed the whole group.
I am General Anthony McAuliffe, United States Army retired. I was at Bastogne with the 101st Airborne Division in 1944. One of the saddest and most dramatic incidents occurred on Christmas Eve night. We had asked for volunteers when we lost our hospital, and a very fine trained nurse, the daughter of the village hardware storekeeper, Renee Lemaire, volunteered. She took charge of a group of wounded from the 10th Armored Division in a house on the main street of Bastogne. But on Christmas Eve, a 500-pound bomb struck the house, went all the way through, and none of the 10th Armored Division soldiers, nor Rainy the Mayor, not a one survived.
On December 26th, elements of the 4th Armored Division crashed into Bastogne. The encirclement was broken. And for the Germans, it was the beginning of the end.
After we'd been in there about 30 days, on the 16th of January, we were relieved. We left Bastogne in one of the worst blizzards I've ever seen. Going up Longwy Hill, about 40 miles south, great big long hill with a gentle slope, the tanks just couldn't make it. They were sliding back like bears on a slippery slide. In thinking it over, I've decided that if we had been in Bastogne alone without any infantry, we couldn't have held 10 minutes. The 101st Airborne, without the steel that my outfit afforded, could not have held. But the steel of my outfit and the blood and flesh of their outfit made a pretty tough combination.
It's always seemed regrettable to me that Combat Command B of the 10th Armored Division didn't get the credit it deserved in the Battle of Bastogne. All of the newspaper and radio talk was about the paratroopers. Actually, the 10th Armored Division was in there a day before we were and had some very hard fighting before we ever got into it. And I sincerely believe that we would never have been able to get into Bastogne if it had not been for the defensive fighting of the three elements of the 10th Armored Division who were first into Bastogne and protected the town from invasion by the Germans.
On the 20th of February, 1945, following a much-needed rest and refitting, the 10th Armored Division was rolling in high gear again. The mission this time was to clear the Saar-Moselle Triangle and capture the city of Trier, an important supply and communication center, and one of the most heavily fortified areas in the world. This was the job General Patton had started in November of 1944, but left unfinished because of the Ardennes counteroffensive.
I am Colonel James O'Hara. I commanded the 54th Armored Infantry Battalion of the 10th Armored Division. Our division was involved in action in the Somme-Moselle Triangle on two different occasions. On the first occasion, I was not involved. On the second occasion, it was after the Battle of Bastogne. We were told to drive to Sarrebourg. As I recall, the 94th Division, which was an infantry division, cleared the way through the Siegfried Line, and we followed and got into Sarrebourg with little incident. When we got up to the Saar River, our division headquarters moved into the town of Ail and planned a river crossing. For this river crossing, General Pyburn, who commanded CCA, was put in command. He was given all three of the armored infantry battalions as his command and told to take them over the river in assault boats and seize the high ground on the other side.
My name is John Drew Devereaux. I was a company commander in the 10th Armored Division during World War II. I think the river crossing we did on the way to Trier was one of the things that I would least like to have to do again. We did it at night, and it's always more difficult to do something at night, and it's a lot more scary. We carried these assault boats for what seemed like about 5 miles through the woods. When we came out of the woods at the edge of the river, we had to go across a lot of open field and over some fences. While we were going through there, it was pitch dark, of course, and all of a sudden we walked into not only a minefield, but the whole place was booby-trapped. Just as the first mine or first booby trap went off, of course, they began to let us have it with mortar and artillery fire, and people screaming, "Medic," you didn't know whether you should put your foot down again in front of you for fear you were going to step on something, whether you should just stay right where you were, or what to do. It was about as scary a thing as I've ever been through. We finally got to the river, crossed without too much trouble. But I tell you, it was a great feeling to get on the other side and get on solid ground again.
We got up to the top of the hill, and down in the valley below, there we met again with General Pyburn. There was not too much action at this time, and we saw many prisoners coming to the rear. However, there were a number of pillboxes which had to be cleared out. And General Pyburn gave us our choice of when to clear these pillboxes out. Some of them did it, cleaning them out in the daytime, I mean some of our battalions. In my case, I decided to clear these pillboxes at night.
We'd had a lot of training back in the States on how to take a pillbox, so when it came our turn to do this, we were fairly well prepared for it. We crawled through about 1,500 yards of open field, got down into an anti-tank ditch, and then the approved routine was that your bazooka man was to fire his bazooka at the observation slit of the pillbox while a couple of the others went around the back and threw grenades in. Well, I turned to the bazooka man and I said, "Okay, now you fire at the observation slits." And he said, "Okay." And he turned around to the rocket man, say, "Give me the rocket for the bazooka," only to find that the rocket man was lying on his stomach about 1,500 yards way back where we'd started. So there was nothing much to do there but take a couple of N1s and pop away at the slit while the platoon sergeant and myself went around the back. It was rather like the movies. Platoon sergeant would open the door back door of the pillbox, and I'd take a grenade and throw it in, and then we'd heat slam the door, and we'd both lean on it, make sure nobody got out. We did this pretty well all afternoon, and I think about the end of the afternoon, we had maybe 100, 150 prisoners.
By February 21st, 48 hours after the attack on the Zaragoza triangle began, the Tigers of the Tenth, together with elements of the 94th Infantry Division, had overrun 85 square miles of German real estate and captured 23 towns, thus setting the stage for the subsequent capture of Trier.
The 10th Army was then given the mission of taking the town of Trier. So we were sent down the road and were told to capture Trier, and we had to go through a town called Zerf. By the time we got up near the town of Zerf, we found that the Germans, which we had knocked out from the area around the river, had retreated just behind Zerf, and they were zeroing in on Zerf with heavy artillery.
I had gone past Zerf in the morning and found that the town was boiling with artillery. Didn't see how anybody could live there. I moved on up to a battalion that had lost its whole headquarters. Some sick, some absent, one killed. And my executive and I took over this battalion. It was raining, it was dark, they were shelling. At the same time, General Patton was raising Cain with General Walker, the corps commander, who was raising Cain with General Morris, the division commander, who was raising the devil with me, to get into Trier. As I said, practically all the division was around Trier except my little force that was just being relieved at Zerf. Lieutenant Colonel Richardson was commanding. I heard that he was to be relieved by the Rangers in the afternoon. "Get into Zerf," they were yelling over the radio. I sat in the headquarters that evening with Roberts, my exec, and we used an old map and decided we'd play this as a map problem. We wanted to go around to the right, but we found out that it was dark, we didn't have guides, it was loaded with mines. We knew there's big minefields up there, we're afraid to do that. The only road was directly into Trier, but you couldn't hold a hand up in the afternoon on this road because the Germans were on the ridges on each side, so we couldn't figure on this road. But all at once it occurred to us that it was black and the Germans couldn't see anybody on the road, so we decided we'd send him down this road. Richardson got loose, came into the headquarters. We told him he's going in. He brought his young officers in, briefed them. I remember he told one outfit, "I'll take the bridge to the right, you take the bridge to the left." It happened that we knew that these two bridges were still intact from airplane photographs that day. To make a long story short, Richardson got into town and his bridge blew up in front of his face. He hadn't heard a boom for the other bridge, so he rambled down in his tank to the other bridge, found out that it hadn't blown, that there was a little shooting from this end of the bridge, but it was sporadic and wasn't organized. He organized a platoon, sent it across the bridge. He had his tank and some other stuff fire on the other end of the bridge, and fortunately they got across. They captured the man the officer who was supposed to blow it. He directed them to 10 or 11 other officers who would have told on him if they'd got away. They were in the back of cafe, so we got the whole group.
My name's John Winter. I was a tank platoon sergeant of the 10th Armored Division during World War II. After Trier was taken, we shoved on to Wittlich, Germany. After taking Wittlich, we pulled back to Trier, and we was promised the rest. But my particular platoon, and a platoon of infantry, was given the mission of, on the opposite side of the mountain from Trier, to try to take a bridge intact.
We started out under the cover of darkness. As we approached in this valley, where the bridge was supposed to be, the Germans were set with 88s and infantry awaiting for us. That's where I lost my tank. When it was hit, it immediately burnt, and I bailed out the top of it, dived out the top, and run into a large dairy barn for cover.
On the 16th of March, the entire division was pushing toward the Rhine. To get there, the Tigers dealt with endless enemy pillboxes, dragon's teeth, roadblocks, and worst of all, about 100,000 well-trained German troops.
I'm Colonel Curtis L. Hankins. I was a battalion commander of the 61st Armored Infantry Battalion in the 10th Armored Division. One event that I remember on the race to the Rhine concerns the destruction of a German supply column. This took place between Kaiserslautern and Frankenstein. With the aid of the Air Force, who had modeled up some German vehicles carrying the day, we were able to destroy an entire German army's supply train. This was recognized as one of the greatest concentrations of enemy equipment of the entire war. And General Patton came down to take a look at this and said it was the most fantastic destruction of an enemy column that he had seen during the entire war.
The Tigers reached the Rhine Valley in a little over a week, capturing in their drive 8,000 prisoners, cutting off the escape route for more than 50,000 Germans. On the 28th of March, they crossed the Rhine at Worms for the final cleanup that was to take them clear to the Austrian and Bavarian Alps. 3 days later, after heavy fighting, the division rolled through the historic university city of Heidelberg. But the Tigers were getting tired. After 6 months of continuous, vicious fighting, the division was now 50% below strength, and the men were showing the inevitable signs of wear and tear. This was a dangerous situation. Although the Germans were definitely on the run, they still packed a murderous wallop. On the 3rd of April, 1945, the 10th Armored Division and a battalion of the 100th Infantry Division received orders to seize the town of Heilbronn and continue east.
I am Lieutenant Colonel George Hamill. During World War II, I was a company commander in the 21st Tank Battalion, 10th Armored Division. The division had been ordered to seize the city of Heilbronn, a key communications center. And our battalion, Task Force Riley, had driven up to the very gates of Heilbronn, only to find that the bridges across the Neckar River were blown in our faces. The division was then ordered to attempt to cut off Heilbronn from the rear. Task Force Hankins crossed the Neckar River north of Heilbronn and made a wide sweep into Kreilsheim. They ran into very little opposition. We were ordered to follow Task Force Hankins, pass through at Kreilsheim, and continue on towards Schwäbisch Hall. We successfully passed through Kreilsheim and through the next large town called Ilshofen and penetrated deeper into German territory when we came to some blown bridges and were completely stopped. By this time, the Germans had reacted to this penetration into their rear.
German reaction was violent. It was his greatest display of strength since the Ardennes offensive. By the 8th of April,
Freilsheim
had been cut off by the Germans.
Supplies were running low for the Americans in the city,
and it looked as though another Bastogne might be in the making. But the Air Force came through again. In the next 2 days, transports from the 9th Troop Carrier Command brought the necessary gasoline, rations, and ammunition to sustain the Tigers. Despite their ability to beat off one enemy attack after another, the Tigers could not maintain supremacy of Freilsheim without reinforcements, and reinforcements were not available. As a result, the mission was changed, and the division ordered to withdraw from the area.
We all resented, I think, the fact that we had to give up this terrain that we'd taken and held. Certainly, we were not driven out. We withdrew.
It was a sad disappointment indeed to receive orders to withdraw from Freilsheim, especially after it appeared that the overall objective had been won.
From the 11th to the 22nd of April, the combat-fatigued Tigers streaked south. By the 23rd of April, they stood poised along the north bank of the Danube River, southeast of Ulm, where the 44th Infantry Division was already fighting, and where intelligence reports indicated the 1st German Army planned to make a desperate stand.
The city fell in a matter of a few hours. As the lead vehicle passed the outskirts of the town at 8:54 in the morning, I immediately sent the message back to combat command. And a few minutes later, the Paris radio announced that the American forces had captured Ulm, when in fact we were still fighting there.
With the capitulation of Ulm, the 10th's three combat commands raced forward with violent effectiveness. Town after town was gobbled up in the great rush.
Our division was ordered to attack down through the Bavarian Alps to the Brenner Pass to link up with American troops coming north through Italy. The Germans had threatened to make a last-ditch stand in what was referred to as the German National Redoubt area. There had been a lot of talk about undercover activities by what the Germans referred to as werewolves. As we approached the Alps, we could see them from a distance, and it certainly made all of us pause, wonder what awaited us. They were very beautiful, great snow-capped peaks, but for an armored unit, it was also rather forbidding. Actually, when we got into the Alps, we found very little resistance, and our battalion went down into Garmisch-Partenkirchen through the town of Murnau. Another column went down through Oberammergau.
While clearing the roadblock at Oberammergau, the scene of the world-famous Passion Play, an International Red Cross representative came up to the other side of the roadblock. He had with him a German captain. They wanted to negotiate for the city of Garmisch-Partenkirchen, the scene of the 1936 Winter Olympics. They wanted us to agree not to shoot up the town. After considerable discussion, we agreed not to shoot unless the Germans fired at us first. When we arrived at the town, the International Red Cross representative escorted us through the town, and the Germans lived up to their bargain and didn't begin firing until we were well beyond the city. This ended the war for my task force, and I can't think of a better place to end it than Garmisch-Partenkirchen.
I'm Colonel Thomas Chamberlain. During World War II, I commanded the 11th Tank Battalion of the 10th Armored Division. If the staff of the division had spent 2 years trying to pick out the best place to end the war, they could not have done as well as we actually did. There were big hotels on the lakes where the men could go swimming and boating. Of course, plenty of skiing and ice skating. In addition, there were horses available so that they could go horseback riding. It made a fine place to relax after the war.
The war was over and won. The Tigers of the 10th had met and conquered the best of the enemy. They had covered 600 bitter, bloody miles from Cherbourg to the Brenner Pass, fighting almost every inch of the way. They had taken 56,000 prisoners and 600 cities and towns. Yes, the war was over and won. The fighting was finished.